Hi, welcome to the Web Technologies Hangout. This is a thing that we've been doing on Fridays to just talk about the web technology world and what happened this week, what we're working on, just chat about anything related to web technologies. I'm Jonathan Belcher. I'm Belcher J on Twitter. I work at Automattic and I work on WooCommerce.com doing all the JavaScripty things. Andrew, introduce yourself.
Sure. I'm Andrew. I also work at Automattic, mostly on WordPress.com. So I guess I'm most interested in some of the React and Redux and JavaScript discussions that we'll be having.
Sounds great. And Ben?
Hi, I'm Ben, also Automattic. Also work on WordPress.com. I work mostly on the Reader. And yeah, same set of interests, mostly around the Redux and React and those bits.
Kevin?
Yeah, I'm Kevin Killingsworth, coder Kevin pretty much anywhere, GitHub, Twitter, that sort of stuff. I also work at Automattic, and I work more on the WooCommerce e-commerce system and also looking into a lot of Redux, React type stuff lately too.
Peyton?
I'm Peyton, Sir Brillig everywhere, and I also work at Automattic. I am a JavaScript developer, mostly working on the customizer.
Oh, cool. I didn't know you worked on that.
Yep, even more so now.
Yeah?
Yeah, as the new initiative to add content block editing to the editor and to the customizer or whatever, yeah. Whatever it turns into, is kicking off now. So
that's exciting.
Yeah.
Very cool. All right. So I had a list of topics, you know, things that came out this week and last week. And we can just go ahead and start at the top unless anybody has anything else they're really itching to talk about. So the first one was their best of JS. Oh, I'm sorry. It's bestof.js.org. They put out the Rising Stars 2016. And I found it sort of interesting in the breakdown. If you look at the first top one there, it's most popular projects in 2016. And it has Vue.js at the very, very top. And like, I was really surprised to see that it has that much popularity. And it looks like they're doing it with GitHub stars, which I don't know that is a valid measure of a project's popular. Well, I guess it is. It's a valid measure of their popularity. But has anybody used Vue?
I'm familiar with it, and I know it's gained a lot of traction to this list. I'm sort of curious if it's for the year of 2016, the mm-hmm. number of additional stars. Like maybe it's the fact that React just had so many stars. Like I start React back in 2014 or something.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that the traction of new stars project per project is probably dependent on how new a project is.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I think that's what that chart represents, is added stars this year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it says 26.4K. Yeah. So
I know I'm familiar with Vue, especially in the Laravel PHP landscape. It seems to have really taken off. And Laravel in general is a framework that's gained a lot of traction over the last couple of years. And I know that there's a lot of screencasts, and that the main developer behind Laravel really enjoys Vue. And it seems to be a framework that appeals to the segment of developers that are focused on just being really productive in JavaScript and implementing more of the rich interactions of a JavaScript application without being so invested or having that ramp up onboarding period as something more like React and getting involved in the JavaScript ecosystem and familiarizing yourself with all the packages therein. I think Vue is really appealing to the people that just want to start with something and really be able to build quickly without having to just spend so much time learning before even getting started.
Yeah, I took a look at Vue. I guess it was sometime last year, and it does get around. Like, first you have to spend 5 days figuring out your build system, and then understanding what all these, you know, the JSX stuff. And so yeah, I totally second that.
It's kind of funny. I've built so many side projects, and still every time I do it, I feel that I spend hours and hours just tweaking my Webpack config to get it just right. Every single time, I've probably built 20 projects, and every time I go through that same experience.
And now you can spend some more hours because there's Webpack too.
Yeah, well, that's part of it, I guess, because more recently I've been using the betas for Webpack too, and so I'm already a little familiar with what's going on there.
Yeah. I think most of the time that I'm changing anything about my Webpack config, it's because Webpack has changed, not because my project has changed.
Well, were there any?
Go ahead.
Were there any features in Webpack 2 that like that you got really excited when you say, "Oh, that's now there. I can now do that."
Well, tree shaking is the biggest thing, I think, which is sort of dropping dependencies, being able to do partial imports and drop the exports of a file that aren't being used in a project. I think that will have a pretty big impact, especially on larger projects such as the ones that we work on reducing the size of bundles. And hopefully, because I think a larger part of it depends on the broader ecosystem adopting it. And because now if you download something from NPM or install something from NPM, it's sort of assumed that it's already been pre-compiled and it has some distributable that you're just including into your project, but hopefully moving forward, we sort of rely on importing dependencies from their source, and maybe that way being able to pick off the pieces of that dependency that you're using specifically. So I'd say tree shaking is probably the big one. I think another thing that people really seem to be liking about Webpack 2 is it's dropped a lot of the magic, the parts of it that sort of weren't very clear. And an example of this is where you could, in your loader's configuration, just drop the dash loader part and it would work. Like, so you would go into a project and you'd see loaders Babel, but really it's Babel loader. That's the dependency that you've brought in. So they're making it more explicit in ways that I think should help make it more clear to people who are just looking at a configuration and trying to figure out what it's doing.
On that notion, though, of being able to pull in folks source and then tree shake, has anything emerged on what set of Babelisms those things will use? Because like we run part of, what do we run, like stage 2 and plus a bunch of custom stuff. But if I'm pulling in Joe Schmo's project and he's running stage 0 stuff, how does that fly?
Yeah, that is sort of an interesting consideration. I think it might end up being that you would sort of, as a library maintainer in your README somewhere, you would say if you wanted to pull this in by its source, it's assumed that you would also need to have stage 0 be part of your build process for it to be able to compile correctly, which hopefully not many library maintainers are using such unstable features that it's more of a burden for the consuming project to be able to use it. Hopefully they're using, like, I would say for a library, they should ideally stick to the yearly specifications and not be on those stage features, but who knows.
Yeah, so it seems like you don't need to do it at the feature level, like not even stick to the years, but just be like, I use, you know, static properties or something.
It's hard to list all of those though. As a library maintainer, you don't want to go through and think about all of the things that you're using features wise.
Yeah. And then something slips in because you did include stage zero, and so it works, but then someone else pulls it in and they, you don't realize you're using features. So what would be the reason to pull in a project as the, you know, with the unbuilt source to like include that in your project? I think that you'd be doing yourself a disservice by not using the distribution, like the min file, whatever it would be.
Well, I mean, looking at an example like React, and this is where I think that they will have to change, or I'd see that they have to change, because the way that JSX works is it assumes that there's some React global present in the current module scope. And I think if we ever want React to be tree shakeable, it has to be more of this partial import. And one of the advantages of that is if you're only picking create element and render, and maybe that's it, there are a lot of other things that would be pulled in by just importing from the top level React, I don't know, like prop types and those sorts of things that maybe you're not even using those in your project. And so with tree shaking, you can guarantee that if you're not touching those things, that they will not be pulled into your bundles unnecessarily.
That makes total sense now.
Yeah, and it really comes into play with packages like Lodash and for us, like Griticons or Social Logos or any of these packages that are pretty sizable, but like with Griticons, a given part of Calypso might pull in two or three icons, but you have to pay the bundle cost of all of the Griticons, which is, I think zipped, it's like 20K or 24K. You have to eat that whole thing, even though you're only using one icon.
Yeah.
And for Lodash Minified is still giant. The full package is, I want to say over, I don't remember. I won't quote it. It's big, you know, but if you're only pulling in four each in map, there's no reason to pull in all of Lodash for that. There are other ways around it. Like you can pull in the individual parts, but tree shaking makes it a little more transparent.
You know, one thing I wonder about is problems like these used to be solved with browser caching and using common libraries. So if you think like a specific version of jQuery, if everybody uses that and it's used across a lot of sites, chances are fair that when somebody visits your site, maybe they already have that cached and they don't have to get it from you. And that is something that we would lose, with more of this bundling and relying on tree shaking and that sort of thing. Anybody have any thoughts about that?
Well, so like that means you have to use a CDN. And so I think that for a while there, everybody was using CDNs and it was a great idea. And then, you know, what happens if that CDN puts something nasty in there? And so that's the real concern. I think that for that to really make sense, then at the browser level, they would have to determine, you know, if you're pulling in a specific version of, let's say, like React, that Chrome figures out that you're using React and then pulls it in. But yeah, I totally get what you're saying. With tree shaking, you definitely lose any opportunity to do that sort of thing.
Well, and you also run the risk, and we sort of run this risk as well of, so take the Lodash example. If we're using the bundle splitting features of Webpack and however many different bundles are independently loading in parts of Lodash and are being included in those bundles, in the end, are we really saving much if we're loading six different copies of is equal or something like that? I don't know that we've done those measurements, but it'd be interesting to look at that. And of course, you can use some of the features of Webpack to detect when a certain threshold. I think we're already doing this in our project with I think the feature is called a Commons Chunk plugin. Is that right, Ben?
Yep.
Where you can sort of identify when a particular dependency is used above a certain threshold and pull it off into its own bundle and reuse it that way.
Yeah, it's actually a really, it's a pretty blunt instrument. Especially as we start splitting things up more, because like right now, if you look at the commons chunk is actually dominated right now by reader stuff, because reader stuff reader's been split up a little bit and there's some commonalities that those four or five chunks share. And that's enough to pass the threshold. So then they get inserted into commons, but reader's the only thing that uses it. No one else actually uses them. So it's not, we probably need something even smarter down the road that figures out, that looks at like our groups or looks at things that get used together and finds commonalities across those things and tries to pull those into a common thing, rather than looking across everything. Because, you know, as we split things up finer and finer, the number of, you know, if it's a percentage based chunk, then your odds of getting into commons go way down because there's so many things that you have to be in now to make the grade. And if it's a minimum number of chunks, then the odds that you get in go up because, you know, the percentage basis actually goes down. So it's not a simple problem. No. And from a load perspective, like right now our bounce rate is kind of junky, and I don't want to quote it, but it's not good. You know, no one's bounce rate is good, really. But if we want to drop the bounce rate, we need to drop the amount of things we're loading up front. And the bias we've had so far has been towards, let's preload things because we know that when people hit the app and they move to a different place, we'll have that thing hot loaded or we'll have that thing loaded already and they can get there quickly. But it's feeling like the reality is more, we need to load more specific things early to get them into the application at all, and then maybe sacrifice duplicate loading on the back end, because we're just not, like, if you look at the paths and analytics about how people move through our site, they don't move that far. Like, they come in, they do one thing and they leave, or they come in, they do one or two things maybe and they leave. So doing all the calculations to figure out, you know, what's the thing they're going to need next to get down that path aren't really as important.
Yeah, it's almost like optimizing for time to first interaction rather than optimizing for overall bundle size, which, you know, right, might not be the most important thing.
Right, exactly.
So it sounds like a lot of the bundle issues is that initial like size and load time. Mm-hmm. Does a lot of that get reduced, like, with things like service workers, for instance, and like very heavy caching?
No,
I mean, like your first time is gonna, I mean, for any sizable JavaScript, you know, single page application, it's gonna be tough because you have to load a lot of stuff. But afterwards, is it a better experience?
Yes. But there is no afterwards, is the gist of it. Yes, there are people that come back. There are very, 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 very many more people that don't. And given how often our application changes, even the people that come back are coming back to something that's different than what it was when they came in. Right. So even if we had a service worker in place, we've still got to go and reload the stuff that they needed to see that first thing. Probably in the background, yeah, the experience will be better, but it's not going to be great. And given how big our bundles are today, there's a decent chance that even if you're on mobile or any kind of constrained device, even if you came back immediately, our stuff's going to get dropped out of cache because it's so big, right? So, I think we this is getting very Calypso specific, but
no. Yeah. So we
need to focus on getting our initial deployment bundle, the initial thing that we need to give to a browser to render enough to see us, to be interactive. It needs to come way, way, way down. Like we're at close to 900K zipped, right? To do anything. And that needs to be more like, hopefully like 40K zipped or less than that.
I don't think this is just a Calypso WordPress.com issue. I think this is a modern web framework issue. I think a lot of sites are facing these same exact problems, and they probably have the same issues with bounce rate, right? You know, because it seems these days, most of the time you go to a new site that you've never been to, it's because you followed a link from some social media thing or something else, or Hacker News or whatever, right?
Yeah, most of those aren't single page apps though, mostly. I mean, sites that you're following from Hacker News or from those kinds of places, you know, link distribution, like Twitter, Facebook, Hacker News, whatever. You're generally hitting, honestly, a WordPress site. And that's decently optimized for delivery. At least for delivering content. The Calypso is kind of weird in that it's two or three things, but it's mostly an admin app. So there's a little bit more forgiveness for load times. Meter, less so. Like, I feel like I have to worry about this stuff more than most folks. Any big single page app is going to run into these issues.
I don't see anybody loading up Gmail in less than half a second, right?
Yeah.
And same sort of idea.
Yeah.
Oh, well, they still have a loading bar.
Yeah. Inbox is a little better. Inbox seems like it was built with different tech.
Well, yeah. I mean, Inbox, they were basically able to start from scratch, 3 years after, the Gmail. I don't know when they completely, rewrote the Gmail the Gmail app, but yeah, they had the benefit of starting from brand new.
Yeah. I don't know about you all, but this, just like any of the other complaints about the new web tech stuff, I take in stride. It's all growing pains, right? A lot of people are working to solve these sorts of problems, and we'll solve these and move on to other problems.
Yeah. So just to point out on that same list, the front end frameworks, Angular 2 is up there. Well, that was released in 2016. So that makes sense. There's Inferno and Preact, which is pretty cool. I think we've talked about that before, unless anybody wants to talk about that now. Those two?
I've actually been using Preact personally in some side projects, and it's pretty amazing the benefits that you get in the drop and bundles, it's so much smaller than React. It's great. It's some of the things that you don't even realize from cutting that size. For example, the rebuild times in Webpack are really nice because it's just frankly a much smaller project. And it, in some ways, because I've read a little bit on how it works, and I don't know, maybe somebody will tell me I'm wrong, but my understanding is that it's more bare metal in how it actually diffs against the DOM rather than not having its own internal representation of what the DOM is. I don't know that it has a virtual DOM in the same way that React or Inferno does. And some people say that that's a disadvantage because it has to make has to touch the DOM to be able to do that diffing, but it kind of feels a little less magical, maybe, in a good way. It's a smaller project that is much more transparent to what it's actually doing.
Yeah. Does anybody, other than like people who spend a lot of time contributing to core React, like understand how React does everything all the time? It seems utterly magical to me.
I would say in the Inferno author, but now the Inferno author is on the React core team. So.
Yeah.
to draw that into a tangent, there's a really interesting article I read recently, which I think is on the list, that attempts to use web components to kind of be React-y, to be a reactive application, to build a reactive application. It's really interesting because they use a separate virtual DOM library and just do all that manually, which it isn't, getting to probably exactly what React and Preact do, but for example, there's no event binding, automatic event binding, or synthetic events at all. I think it's really cool to see, how you could do that sort of yourself, because React, even though the concept is really simple and super, makes it super easy to build components, without having to bind events and things yourself. I had never thought about how to actually do the diffing to the actual DOM and stuff, and that article was very insightful in that.
Sort of to that point, I've noticed this trend of re-implementations of React and also sort of picking out more of the small pieces of React. I think there was one of the posts on the list that did something similar with trying to re-implement a React-like tool in Vanilla.js. Or I remember an article last year, I think, that it was the Pokédex app. I don't know if you all remember that. It was this example of like a progressive web application. And I think, Peyton, to your point, I think he used the same library and he did some techniques where he shifted off the diffing logic into a web worker and did some serialization to sort of manage those updates to the DOM to make sure that the UI changes themselves were sort of independent from the diffing to prevent the UI from being blocked by that logic, which I thought was really interesting. So there's this trend and this theme in a lot of the posts here and that I've seen of trying to basically take what we've learned from React and apply them more generally without React or at a more smaller case.
Well, it worked for Angular too.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Or Ember as well, I think, does diffing as well now. Isn't there Glimmer engine or something?
Yeah, it's called Glimmer. So if you haven't gone to the Pokédex, it's pokedex.org. I put it in the chat. But that is it is amazing. Like looking at how fast the animations and how beautiful it is, it's a fairly simple application and but the number of moving parts and how quickly it does it, it's just incredible.
So, Jonathan, were you glad to see Polymer up on that list?
Wait, Polymer's on the list?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, I'll have to. Oh, yeah, it's right there. So they got, they didn't make the how many stars they added. Yeah, I mean, I'd love to see Polymer there. And, you know, people who look at Polymer really like Polymer. And everybody who complains about all the build issue, you know, Webpack is complex and all of these things are complex. And I tell them, go take a look at Polymer. Like you can implement simple Polymer stuff on an existing website within like minutes. It's great.
I have a question. I don't know if we want to spend much time on it, but Polymer, I read something about how they're coming out with a second version that leverages more of new specifications around custom elements. Is it a totally different thing in much the same way as Angular 1 to Angular 2? Or is it, well, I shouldn't say, I haven't paid attention to that migration path with Angular, but is it going to be a totally different thing from what somebody who might have looked at Polymer a year ago? In a year, is it a different framework?
Yeah. So the to be honest, I haven't spent a whole lot of time looking at the Polymer 2 changes. I have heard from friends that the upgrade path is going to be much less horrific than upgrading an Angular. Oh, had a phone call coming in. So the upgrade path is going to be much easier than say an Angular 1 to an Angular 2, and also that it's going to be they are going to break some things, but they're going to gradually add some things so that you can upgrade your get your app ready to move to Polymer 2. So the upgrade path is going to be much nicer. I don't know to be. I read an article when they first came out with the alpha and, you know, what it entailed, but I'm not up to speed on that.
Yeah. It's sort of interesting, the fallout from Angular and that initial, I just remember the initial announcements around Angular 2 and just the reaction from the community on how it was so different and that it was really off-putting to a lot of people, and I wonder if that actually hurt them in the long term. This worry, because you know, there's a lot of companies that built Angular apps and may have expected them to work long term and for them to be easily upgradable. But if it sort of fell into the traditional JavaScript complaint of everything changing so quickly. And I think that scares a lot of people away. So it's interesting to see. I'm sure that the impact of that will affect other projects as well.
I almost feel like they just shouldn't have called it Angular.
Yeah, I totally agree. Before I was in love with Polymer, I was in love with Angular. And so there were a lot of people that were just like, Angular's like, this is great, this is amazing. And then all of a sudden that happened and they said, well, I don't know what to do. If I'm going to start a new application, well, how do I make it, you know, compatible with Angular 2 a year down the road? So, I mean, we expect our apps to, you know, become obsolete fairly quickly in the current world we live in. But like 6 months from now, and you can't tell me exactly how I build an app so that I can, that there's an upgrade path. And then the Angular 2 took a really long time to get there. And like, I think that was the concern for everybody. I think they announced it too early. I think it needed to be a little bit more complete or maybe some APIs more solidified. Because up until like, even in the release candidates, like things were changing fairly rapidly there. I know a couple of instructors, and so they do Angular classes all the time, and they were trying to teach Angular 2 a month before it came out, and they had to change their instruction, once a month because it was just changing out from underneath of them. And I think that was part of the issue. But yes, absolutely, should have been called something else. Let Angular, you know, in its current form, just live on and go forward. But create this fork or this, and it really wasn't even a fork. Make it something else and go forward with that.
Did anyone in the like the Angular 1 community world end up continuing to push on Angular 1? Like, is it so? Back in, I used to work on Dojo a very long time ago. And for us, it wasn't 1 and 2, it was 0.4 and 1, or 0.4 and 0.9, depending how you looked at it, where we completely changed how widgets worked. It's the same thing. It was a complete, it wasn't a fork, it was just widgets are entirely different now. And there are still people running Dojo 0.4 apps today, because that community ended up kind of going sideways and went off into IBM land. But they still run, and they still get security updates, and they still get, you know, updates and things. It's not gotten pushed as hard, but it's effectively just a different way of doing widgets that the overall Dojo community didn't bless, but it's still gone on its own way. Has that happened with Angular? Like, are there still people pushing on Angular 1?
Yeah, so Google has come out and said that they're going to support Angular 1 dot whatever until the number of people using it drops off. And I don't think they've really specified how they know the number of people using Angular 1 drops off. So they're going to support it and they're not going to add lots of new features, but they're going to security updates and those sorts of things. And I think that there's a huge enterprise community out there that has made a ton of investment in Angular 1 applications that to transition them to Angular 2. Well, one, they don't have the developers to actually do the work because, you know, it's so new. And then two, just the time that it would take. So those, I think that there's going to be a lot of apps that live on in the Angular 1 world, but I think it's going to be to really make those apps move fast and being able to add new features to an Angular 1 app. Well, you got to look and say, hey, does it make sense to make the investment too? And I think there's a lot of apps that are just sort of, hey, this is feature complete. You know, this is an enterprise, screen, and we'll make small changes and we'll go from there. So I think that there's going to be a lot, there'll be a huge market for Angular 1 developers for the foreseeable future, as well as a huge market for people transitioning those apps 2-3 years from now to Angular 2 or Angular 3. Or I think actually the beta for Angular 4 is out.
So it's like the new COBOL. Awesome.
Yeah, actually in high school, my dad had me start learning COBOL so that I could help with Y2K. And so the plan was I was going to make all sorts of money like rewriting COBOL code. So I still remember a little bit of COBOL.
Nice. High school and Y2K.
Well, yeah, I sort of dated myself. I don't know. So the other one that was, I found pretty interesting in all these other lists, if you go down to the Node.js frameworks on that same article, I'll keep going back to, it seems like a lot of the Node frameworks are sort of frameworks that have been around for a bit. It seems like Node maybe slowed down a little bit and solidified, you know. I mean, Express, Koa, I'm not familiar with Feathers. Nodals is at least 2 years old. Sails is a couple years old. Happy is a couple years old. So maybe that slowed down a little bit and we can actually learn Express and feel happy about our knowing some Node.
Well, yeah, I wonder how much this is just like the progression of an ecosystem that it starts out so rapidly evolving and then sort of settles into like a status quo. Or also, at least looking at my own experience, I've sort of moved from trying not, well, because I'm primarily a front-end developer, I've tried to move to this mindset of the back-end being such a small thing. And for many of my projects, Express or maybe Koa, these very small libraries are enough for me to get the APIs that I need without too much trouble. And I don't find myself looking for more than just those solutions.
Yeah.
I've always learned stuff in Express like I've learned stuff in Python. I've never actually really tried to learn it. I just look up the docs and kind of use it.
Yeah.
I mean, like React and Redux and, you know, even Webpack and some of that stuff, it's kind of a commitment to learn, right? And you're not going to get a whole lot done without really digging in. But I kind of like some of those other things that you don't have to expend a lot of mental energy to use. And I think Express fits into that category.
Yeah, it's one of those, it's such a small API, but so powerful in what it's capable of. It's kind of like a simple, but, you know, even though it's simple, you can still do pretty much anything that you would want to do with it.
Yeah, and it's really easy to do the easy things. Like, the easy stuff is really straightforward. You can still do hard stuff, but it's, yeah. That's one place I actually feel like Redux falls down, where to do anything simple in Redux is hard. And to do hard stuff in Redux is really, really hard. Or extraordinarily simple, depending. It's, yeah, you get, Redux seems to lend itself to extraordinarily dense code, where you're doing something really powerful, but you're doing it in two lines. And figuring out all the implications of what you just did are sometimes hard.
Is that not like a general, you could say that about most functional code?
Yeah. It's like reading, I mean, to date myself, it's like reading Lisp. Like it's, you can say things in Lisp that are extraordinarily terse and extraordinarily powerful. And understanding what you just said is sometimes very hard. Or understanding all the implications can be difficult.
Well, and in Perl, you can do it all in one line.
Yeah, exactly. But then you don't understand it. It just does magic.
Yeah. The next thing I wanted to talk about was the Mozilla redesign, and I think it's awesome. What say you?
The fact that you couldn't type it into the browser day one, big mistake.
Yeah, that's it. What was it, a GitHub issue, or where did they put that issue? Because that was fun. That was a good read.
I didn't see the issue. I just saw lots and lots of chatter. It's like, you guys do this and you don't support it in Firefox the day you push it? Come on. Which I pretty much agreed with. We need that Easter egg. It's key. It's pretty. It's cool.
Feels very retro, at least a lot of the branding around it. It's very...
Yeah, it's got like a wired 1998 feel to me.
Yeah.
With the way they did the highlighting and the font choice and stuff.
There was some commentary I saw about how it looks very similar to the new Curl logo, which the Curl author apparently works for Mozilla, so...
Somehow I totally missed this.
it's definitely fun. Let's see. Oh.
That particular image, I just keep shaking my head.
Yeah, sorry about that. I use something called Shush. And if I hold down my my function key, it allows me to talk. And then when I stop talking, I release the key. And that way, everybody doesn't have to listen to all the noise in the background. In my new office, there is a hair salon right there. And you can hear them straight through the door. So I got to do some soundproofing. But the link I just posted in the chat is a prettier formatter. And so... Prettier formats your JavaScript. So I saw some chatter. I think Andrew, you were talking about this, or I think it was Andrew. Somebody was talking about it, and I think it's awesome. I've used the JS format in the past. And that was really useful. So every time you hit save, it goes through your code and just puts it in a specific format. But I remember having some issues with that and some issues around the ES6 stuff. But this is fully compliant and does all the great JavaScript-y things. The only problem is I think you pretty much have to make your JavaScript look like his JavaScript.
Yeah, it's not configurable. It's just an opinionated version of JS format with ES6 support. We had something like it for Calypso for a while, back before we did the ES6 move. We using JS format. I came up with a set of rules that pretty much adhered to our coding style. I love it. I love these things. I think it's, if you enforce it all the time and everyone uses it, then you stop having arguments about code style, or stop having, you don't spend any time in review on code style. It's just right. Even if it's not what you love, it's always the same.
Go kind of does this by default. And I think that I don't know. I'm sure that wasn't the first. In fact, the JS format may have come before that. I don't really know. But I feel like that really proved that a community could get behind it and just be like, okay, well, we don't have to worry about code formatting. We can just code, and the code formatting takes care of itself. Clever.
Yep.
Yeah,
really,
I feel like
kind of fun thing is you can go both ways with it, right? So you can have the thing that takes code from any format and puts it into the good format, but you can also have a thing that goes the other way and takes any code and puts it into the format that you like. So when you open your editor, it can transform it to what you like, and then when you save it, transform it to what everyone else says is okay. And you never have to leak the fact that you really like 8-tab. You know.
Oh, you're a leading commas person? Ah.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, yeah. Oh, you don't like semicolons? That's fine. You can have no semis in your editor, and we'll have semis over there.
That's a neat idea. I didn't think about that.
I guess maybe I'm on the other side a little bit on this one. I've not been able to get excited about a lot of these explicit code formatters that format every single line of code, because I've found that sometimes you lose some nuance in how you craft your code. So maybe you really wanted that empty line after this one line because it logically separates that little bit of code in that function, and you lose things like that with a formatter.
Add a comment.
Yeah, or the oh, or the format is just being too is being overly aggressive. Like the way we had that was the rule was you couldn't have more than one blank line, but you could have a blank line.
Like, yeah,
and that was arbitrary, and it was you could have a function that was there was a blank line between after every statement, and that would pass the formatter, and it wouldn't change it. If you had doubles in there, it'd change them all to singles. And if you didn't have any space, it would allow that too. So you can have some degree of flexibility within the rigid rule set. So, I mean, it could just be, I think those cases are usually more, the rule set's a little too rigid and you can loosen it up.
Yeah. Another example of where I've run afoul of issues with formatters is, you know, what do you do when a line gets too long? And what does that look like, you know, splitting it out into multiple lines? And, you know, that can be different for different things, right? If you have a parameter list, maybe you, you know, that's easy enough. But, you know, what if you have an object? How does that look? And things like that.
Or if are you taking something that's nice and long and putting it into a variable just to shorten the line? So now you're impacting performance, very minor. You're creating, you know, you're creating a point rather than just putting it directly in. Does that make sense? Like shorting your line, but having to create multiple variables to shorten that line.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm actually fairly liberal with doing that sort of thing, especially if it improves readability. I'm fairly notorious for creating local variables that are more descriptive, just to throw them in an if list, stuff like that.
Yeah, I do the same thing.
Yeah,
I would almost worry that some of these prettiers mask that from you, where you should be spending the time to sort of manually figure out like should this be split off into a separate variable, whereas the prettier would probably just be kind of dumb about it and sort of collapse it onto a second line and indent it or something like that.
Yeah, like you would have instead of you know, five variables to break out the conditions of an if statement, it would just keep entering down and you would have an if statement that's like 7-8 lines long. Yeah, I'm with you there. That is a concern. For me, I think the biggest part about having a non-configurable code formatter is that as an industry, more people are writing the same JavaScript that looks exactly the same. And so you can jump from project to project to project to project. Today, like, I mean, I think that there's like fairly standard and, you know, ESLint and all of the linters have sort of condensed the variability in the way JavaScript is written down pretty well. There's still differences. But long ago, when you looked at two different projects, you had to spend a lot of time to figure out what was going on because the JavaScript was written in a different way, like the leading commas. Yeah, leading commas are basically impossible for me to grok that very quickly. So for me, I think that the most exciting part is that we're all going to write JavaScript in a more similar way, and the amount of time that we have to spend thinking about those changes is smaller.
But that assumes that you agree with what that standard is. Because, you know, I might look at, and especially in the JavaScript ecosystem, I feel very strongly in my own code about being excessive, having excessive spaces and using tabs. I'm a tab person, but in the broader JavaScript ecosystem or one of these standards, it's probably spaces. It probably doesn't have spaces between parentheses, things like that. That I don't know. I am more strongly committed to my own personal coding style that I'm not sure I could totally get on board with that. I would like to see it. I would like to see something that takes is like these tools, but takes an ESLint configuration and based off of that figures out how the code should be formatted. Because I think you sort of kill two birds with one stone that way. And you reuse what's already sort of pretty prevalent in JavaScript projects anyways, which is your ESLint configuration that says like how it should be spaced and what is the max length of a line and those sorts of things.
And I think ESLint to some extent does do that. I mean, in a lot of the rules they have fix. You know, they have how do I fix this thing? And I mean, it's not as extensive as Prettier, but you can run fix and it'll go through and take care of most of the problems. But there's some of the ESLint rules that figuring out how to fix that thing is just too complex to really do well and 100% not going to break your code.
Yeah, that's good that you raised fix, because I think that's kind of a very similar in purpose to what these Prettiers are doing. And maybe we should just be running ESLint fix. And I know, yeah, like you said, there's not every rule actually opts into this, but I think it's relatively new. I think it's been around maybe a year or two. And so maybe over time, we'll see more and more rules starting to take advantage of that. I know I've written a few ESLint rules myself, and I think at least a couple of them I've written fixers for, which is kind of cool.
I know you have for at least one, because I use them all. Ben, you dropped a link for standard JS.
Oh yeah, I just find it funny that there's like trying to find the one true standard, and there's like five or six one true standards, of course.
Yeah, Airbnb has one too.
Yeah, everyone has.
It's very popular.
Yeah.
For me, like when I jump on a new team, I don't care what the standard is, and I'm very like tabs, spaces, you know. I prefer to use semicolons, but if they don't want to use semicolons, if that's the standard for the team that I'm working on, I don't care what it is, I'll use whatever you use, but we've got to enforce it. And so I think that, you know, these tools are awesome and all that fun stuff. All right, what else do we have on the list? Oh, it's 11:58, so I guess we're pretty much square, unless anybody has anything else they want to talk about today.
Well, Jonathan, I would like to agree with you. I've been around this code format thing for too long. I just don't care anymore. Let's just have a standard. Let's follow it. I don't even care what it is, as long as it's consistent.
And so I'd like to thank my dog for being such a great participant. He didn't make any sound whatsoever the entire time.
Ditto.
All right. Well, sounds great. I'll talk to everybody next week. And adios.
See you. Thank you. Later.